from ABC News Radio, KMET 1490 in Southern California. This is Biz Ninja Entrepreneur Radio with your host, Tyler Jorgensen.
Welcome out to Biz Ninja Entrepreneur Radio. I'm your host, Tyler Jorgensen. And today we have somebody who has made a huge impact in my life personally on the show. She is a prolific author, a CPA, a CEO, a mentor, and is many things to many people. Welcome out to the show, Sharon Lechter.
Thank you so much, Tyler. I'm delighted to be with you. It just means I'm old. I've been around a long time. Lots of hats.
Not everyone that's old makes impact, and you have made a ton of impact and continue to do so. So I'm really excited to have you on the show and chat with you about your journey. Do you consider yourself an entrepreneur?
Oh, absolutely. Through and through. I grew up in a very entrepreneurial home, Tyler. I lived in a little tiny house between my mom's beauty shop, my dad's used car lot. We had rental properties that at 10 years old, I was scrubbing out bathrooms between tenants. We owned orange groves where we had the cash flow from oranges. So I was steeped in the entrepreneurial mindset.
You were born into the hustle, that's for sure. Wow. Yeah. And so you, I think a lot of people, for me, in my experience, many CPAs that I've met are not entrepreneurial. So I'm very curious how you landed in the, you know, years now of being a CPA, but also in the entrepreneurial world. How did you like find that path?
I love that question, Tyler, because it was in my mid-30s that I found something called the Kolbe test, K-O-L-B-E. Yeah. And it helped me understand, because I kind of thought I was schizophrenic. So I had this conservative risk-averse accountant always fighting with this innovator risk-taker inside the same brain. And when I took the Kolbe index, it helped me understand that, you know, my natural ability, my cognitive ability is one of innovation and risk-taking. I trained myself in going to school and following the rules and learning accounting to become the other side of the brain, more of a risk-averse, conservative, no risk-taking. So I always had that thing battling inside me, but now I know where it's coming from, so I can accept it.
Interesting. So you were a risk taker first and trained yourself to have discipline, as opposed to many people who are in the financing world who they are disciplined by nature and have to almost learn risk taking.
And I'm not sure. I think as an entrepreneur to be successful, you have to have a certain amount of discipline.
For sure.
The issue is that you're in control of your actions, you know, and as an employee, you're responding to someone else's requirements. And so that's probably the biggest distinction for me. I really am a control freak. I like to control what I do, when I do it, and who I do it with. And that's easier done when you're in the driver's seat.
I totally agree. Speaking of controlling what you do and who you do it with, one of the first time you came into my realm of experience and understanding, and the first time I kind of saw you in my sphere, was as the co-author of Rich Dad, Poor Dad. How did that happen?
Well, it's. I'll try to give you the short version.
I'm sure it's a long story.
Yeah. So as we shared, I had many years as an accountant, as a CPA, one of the very first women in public accounting. And at the ripe old age of 25, I said, "This is crazy. I'm working for someone else." And so that's when I started my entrepreneurial career. Started a woman's magazine, sold it. Started the world's first talking children's book. I just had another interview. Have to have it here. Industry back in the late 80s.
I remember those.
Grew this around the world. You probably had them when you were a kid. And it was like the first technology kids had had. So I said, how do we get parents to trust us? And so we aligned with little companies like Disney, Warner Brothers, Sesame Street, Marvel Comics. And I learned so much about business and the power of association, the power of brand association. And so we sold that company in 1991. And that's when my husband and I moved our family to Arizona. And in 92, our oldest son went off to college in September, came home in December in credit card debt. I was pretty mad at him, but more mad at myself because we didn't know he had credit cards. He got them when he went on campus.
Right.
And so that was December of 92. And that's when I dedicated the rest of my career to financial literacy, financial education. So in 92, I started working with schools, hence the white hair, if you ever tried to work with school systems. And a few years later, I get a phone call from my husband and he had this guy walk into his office in flip-flops and a Hawaiian shirt with this idea for a board game. And my husband is a well-known intellectual property attorney. So Robert Kiyosaki had come to him with this idea for a board game and wanted to know if he could patent it. And so I met Robert at the very first beta test for the cash flow game and loved it. I was the only one that got out of the rat race, and it was totally consistent with what I was teaching. And so I volunteered to help him with all my contacts to be able to get the book commercialized and separated actually into two games to make it more a little less difficult the first time around. And during that process, he told me he wanted to charge $200 for the game. And I said, that's kind of pricey. We're talking 1996 for a board game, $200. I said, you should probably write a brochure that gives you that philosophy, shares what that is. And so that brochure, people don't know this, was Rich Dad, Poor Dad. We never expected it to take on a life of its own. We thought our brand was Cashflow, wow, the name of the game.
Yeah.
And so people wanted more after we released Rich Dad, Poor Dad. And so we said, okay, we'll write a trilogy. So we did Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Cashflow Quadrant, Rich Dad's Guide to Investing, thinking three and done. No. Over the 10 years we were partners in Cashflow Technology, wrote 15 books together. And then I launched another series called Rich Dad Advisors. So we became not just this massive book company, game company, but also other products, infomercials, audio products, as well as the multiple books. So,
yeah. And then, speaking engagements, you were filling event centers, right? In presentations.
We were truly a viral marketing success before the internet and before Amazon. I know that's hard for a lot of people to believe, but it was.
So I think what's fascinating is you said you took the Colby test and it helped you kind of understand a little bit about who you are. Rich Dad, Poor Dad was the book that made me feel like I'm not broken. Mm-hmm. I grew up in a very conservative home. My dad had an entrepreneurial spirit, but was not an entrepreneur. And I just saw the world differently than everyone I grew up around. And reading Rich Dad, Poor Dad, it was like, oh, this isn't weird.
It grants permission to believe differently. Yeah. It gives people that. And that's part of the effectiveness of Rich Dad, Poor Dad and how I write in all my books. It's not telling somebody what to do. It's sharing the possibility so that people can relate heart to heart, say, wow, if they can do it, I can too.
Yeah. And I think that book is very much a metaphor, right? It's very much, here's a concept, but it's not necessarily super practical. And that's where the rest of your courses and everything probably.
Just the title, you immediately relate to the book because you go, okay, I had the rich dad or I had the poor dad. And so just that one step makes you relate. And so you dig in deeper to see it and you see the thought patterns. And yes, it really is the element to just make you start thinking differently. Cashflow Quadrant goes much deeper into understanding the different money mindsets.
Right.
And so it's very important to keep learning.
Yeah, absolutely. So you've written over 30?
26 like it's a books.
Lot of 26.
Yeah.
And then many of them translated into multiple languages, all kinds of things. So of all the books you've written, which one are you the most proud of?
So that's like asking what child is your favorite. I have some interviewers tell me, well, I do have a favorite child. Yeah. No, let's not go there. They're all different.
Yeah.
All right. So if you absolutely was honored and thrilled to be asked by the Napoleon Hill Foundation to bring out Outwitting the Devil, which was hidden away for 73 years. And it really is impactful for today's younger generations to understanding how fear holds us back, how we self-sabotage. So if there's somebody in your life who is like drifting and they don't know what they want to do, that's the book to get them to pay attention.
Sounds
reading
awesome.
Outwitting the Devil and then Think and Grow Rich. Obviously, if you're a woman and you don't have the confidence, I would recommend Think and Grow Rich for Women. It's very impactful. I highlight over 300 women in the book. And then if you're a business owner and you feel like, oh my gosh, I own a job, not a business, or my business isn't growing, I have to be there, I'm the only one that can do it, then you need to buy Exit Rich, because this is my 40 plus years of experience, plus my co-author's experience of 30 years to combine to show people what they need to do to take their successful business and make it sustainable, scalable, and saleable.
Yeah, it's amazing how many people have spent 20, 30, 40 years, a lifetime building a business that can't exist without them, right? And so they should have this amazing asset that has an opportunity to create a liquidity moment but instead they're stuck and it's super sad. And so that your book outlines the path, right?
You just use my favorite word, asset. You know, asset that most people chase money. They exchange time for money. That's the left side of the cash flow quadrant, if you're familiar with that. I teach people to buy, build, or create income-producing assets. And your business should be your most lucrative because you put your time and your energy in your soul. Successful businesses solve a problem or serve a need. And if you want to create this asset or economic engine for your business, you will read Exit Rich, because if you're still involved in the day-to-day, you're restricting your ability to grow.
So I feel like the cash flow quadrant is such a powerful and simple thing, because one of the things it makes you do is say, am I really a business owner right now, or am I self-employed? Right. And so, it's so powerful. I literally drew it out on my paper too, because I'm like, okay, so many people get stuck on that left side, but they think they've moved from employee to business owner, but they didn't. They moved from employee to self-employed, and that's scary. And I often say self-employment is like the biggest lie in America, because you feel like you've done it. You've done the business owner route, but you're stuck in what's actually scarier. And I call it wantrepreneurship. You didn't actually do all the things you need to do to become an entrepreneur. You got stuck.
I love that.
Yeah. And so what is something that you think, like, is there a first step that somebody has to do to move from self-employed to business owner?
Well, that's my superpower, Tyler. Yeah, that's what I help people do, to understand how to disengage and how to build the right structures. Because what happens invariably, an entrepreneur is an innovator. They're fantastic for getting things going, for bringing in the resources to get a business launched. They're not usually very good at the day-to-day. So it's really important they have the right people on your team, people who are strong where you are weak, so that you can continue moving forward in your company. Too many entrepreneurs end up getting stuck in the day-to-day. And so all of a sudden, the momentum starts to slow. And so we talk about the importance of business systems. And in the book, we talk about the six P's. The first one is people, you know, who's on your team. Do you have a mentor? So 75% of the people agree that mentors are important. Only 37% of business owners have them. There's a problem there.
Because that's higher than I would have expected.
Yeah. Mentorship have proven that you make more money when you have a mentor. And so when you have the right people on your team, the right mentor, the right advisors, then you built a stronger build business. Then you, the second P is your product. The third one, your processes. You know, you talk about asset within your business that is an asset. You have business systems, and they are assets within your business, because they're what help you become scalable and sustainable. Because it's a lot easier to manage a system than it is to manage a personality. And right. So business systems. And then the fourth one is proprietary. What gives you your unique competitive advantage? Let's identify your intellectual property, leverage it. Okay, let's identify it, protect it, and then leverage it so that you have multiple streams of income.
I love that. That's, you know, I'm still shocked at the first one, right? That you said, you know, 75% of business owners recognize the need for mentorship and think that it's valuable, but 37%. And in my experience, it feels like it's even less than that, than 37% that actually.
I actually was surprised that it was 37%, yeah. But it was done by universities. So
I believe, yeah.
But yeah.
And it's data. And that's what data is so good at, is helping us.
They may ask somebody if you have a mentor, and because you read a lot of books, you go, yeah, I have a mentor, you know.
Yeah. Well, for a long time, I would have said, yeah, you know, like Robert Kiyosaki is one of my virtual mentors and Tim Ferriss is one of my virtual mentors, but I didn't actually, they weren't technically, there's a difference between having ongoing feedback and a reciprocal relationship.
They're inspirational resources. A mentor is someone who actually steps into your business. Correct. You and helps open doors. They steer you around pitfalls. Right. They open up their Rolodex to support you in building your business, but they literally are in your world, not asking you to step into theirs.
Absolutely. That's a really good distinction. I like that term, inspirational resources versus mentor. And I totally agree with that delineation. You have, you've done a lot of amazing businesses. You've written a lot of amazing books, and your track record is really, really great. Through that time, you've worked with partners. What have you learned through your experience with partnership, and what advice do you give to younger entrepreneurs?
That's a great question, Tyler, because it's so important. You know, half our marriages, you know, fail in divorce. Businesses are no different. You need to plan the divorce before you get married, because there are two of you that want to go into business together. You're really excited about their future. You become good friends if you weren't good friends already. And so everything is rosy and everything is looking up. And that is the time to say, okay, Tyler, you know, we're both excited about this, but you know, in a couple of years, you may decide you want to do something else, or I may decide I want to, how are we going to figure that out in 2 years if one of us wants out? And so you come up with a reasonable system for how to determine valuation of the company so that someone can leave if they need to. You talk about, if something should happen to me, if I die, do you want to be my husband's partner? Maybe not. So let's, you know, have that provision. And so talking about it when you're getting ready to go into it makes it a lot more sense, because when you have high emotion, you have low intelligence. So when you get into a situation where you want to separate, there's probably a little anger, a little resentment, and it's hard to come up with something that's reasonable without bringing in a third party and heaven forbid having to end up in court. And that's something that it's no fun for anybody. I've been there. So
yeah, it's true. And I've told people, I was like, if you can't have the uncomfortable conversation at the beginning of your partnership, what makes you think you're going to be able to have it when you're trying to end it? And so
great.
Like,
I love that line. That's great. Yeah.
That's fascinating. I think you've done so many amazing things, and the number of books you've written and everything is just fantastic. You're still the CEO of Pay Your Family First, which you're the founder and CEO. It's still a financial education company. What is something that you feel like America's education system is just not getting right?
Financial education. Yeah, in the last few years, there's been so much dissension in this country and about the separation of classes. And I just, you know, this is an issue that has no party affiliation. If we truly want every child to have equal opportunity, because we've heard the saying, the rich get richer, the poor get poorer. That's because we learn about money at home. Only seven states require a personal finance class to graduate high school. Only 12 more require some sort of personal finance in another class, which means the boxes get checked the last week before they graduate. And so it's criminal that we're not teaching financial literacy. If we want every person, every child to have equal opportunity, no matter what their economic background, no matter the color of their skin, no matter where they live, we will teach them about money and entrepreneurship in school.
So I had an interesting personal experience. It's kind of similar to what happened with your son. So when my wife went to university, her family told her, man, student loans are really bad. I've heard those are bad. Avoid student loans. So she built up credit card debt instead. Ooh. Right. And so really interesting thing when you teach anecdotal education instead of actual education, right? And financial literacy. How do we fix this, right? I mean, you addressed it with your son. You realize, man, this is happening. These kids are going off to university out into the real world without knowing how things work. They don't know how their credit score works. They don't know how credit works or debt or anything. How do we fix
it? Yeah, I'm as passionate about that today as I was in December of 2012, Tyler. And I think when I made the decision to leave Rich Dad is when I got the call from President Bush. So I was honored to serve both President Bush and Obama as on the first President's Advisory Council for Financial Literacy. During that time, we passed the Credit Card Act that prevents credit card companies from soliciting college students on campus for credit cards. Because my son got into trouble because he got to campus and it was like free pizza, free money, free T-shirt, free money. He had a really good time his first semester in college, because they had all those resources. And then the bill started coming in. And so I was really honored to be part of that. I can't take credit for the bill, but I can take credit for being a very squeaky wheel about the need for it. But we continue to drive home the fact that we cannot wait for the education system to change. So every one of us, as a concerned parent, grandparent, aunt, uncle, just a concerned adult, need to make sure our young people are given the tools. Because financial education is the gift of a lifetime.
Absolutely.
And shame on you if you're not making sure the young people you care about are learning about money. Because at the end of the day, there are no secure jobs. So you want children to understand you either control your money or your money controls you.
Yeah.
There's nothing in between.
Yeah. I heard once that the difference between owing someone $1,000 and having $1,000 in savings is a lot more than just the difference of 2,000, right? It's massively different, the what debt can do to a person versus savings can do to a person over time. And I think what's hard is that so many of our parents and our adults in America don't have a good grasp on the basics of financial literacy. So how are we supposed to impart that to our kids, right? Like, I have four children. They're starting to like get older, and you know, and it's terrifying. Like, I think I'm doing a good job, but I still am not perfect, right?
So you're giving me a perfect opportunity, and you don't even know this. I have a board game called Thrive Time for Teens. And it was developed to teach young people how they spend their money and how they spend their time will either drive them to success or not. And it has a lot of humor in it. The kids start laughing. They pull, you know, cards that say you dropped your cell phone in the toilet, $300. Another one may say you go to a party at a friend's house. Parents are not home. Cops come. You get a $500 ticket. And so there's these things that come up at the table. Sometimes you don't want to hear what they're talking about, but they start laughing and they start sharing, but it starts showing them the consequences of bad decisions without them actually having made the bad decisions.
That's
and
really
so I've
cool.
I'm very proud of the game because it's something that we've done it in schools all over Arizona, Southern California, and it's something that really helps open the children's eyes. And to your point, most of them say, my parents need to play this game. So it's pretty funny.
Yeah, that's I love that. And so what's fascinating is that goes all the way back to where you first started with, you know, when you connected with Robert Kiyosaki about a board game to teach financial literacy, and how amazing the ability of using play to educate, right, and to create awareness.
I love any learning.
It's really neat.
Yeah. Experiential learning. That's how we learn everything. You don't learn to ride a bike by watching it. You know, you have to actually get in there and do it. And it's the same thing. We all make mistakes with money. The issue is, are you learning from it and are you adjusting in what's up here? Because most of the time it's up here. We have the scarcity mindset from learning, you know, growing up in a home that says we can't afford it. Pinch your pennies. Money doesn't grow on trees. So we grow up hearing money negative, money negative. That's why we end up with a scarcity mindset.
Yeah.
And once you see that and can release it, you can realize we live in a world of abundance and you are in control of your own destiny.
You know, man, it's, I think it's interesting. I've always been passionate about these concepts. But I think seeing my kids get older, it's a different type of like,
well, I have the same level, passion right? for kids. Yeah. Well, when you see your own children making bad decisions, you go a little cuckoo. So like I did, but you know, there's a passion on the personal finance, but you know, the greatest pathway out of that is through the business and understanding how to build a strong business. And that's why this is really the culmination of my career, of everything that I've learned from helping businesses succeed, building three global brands and having companies that, you know, I've mentored that have succeeded and not. And so showing what to do and how to build that structure within those six P's. I mean, the you know, patrons, your database. So many people now are living in social media and they're so excited about their social media following. The problem is you don't own those names.
No.
You know, social media does. So you want to nurture them and bring them home to build your database in your company. Tremendous value. So we talk to you about all of those steps to help build the valuation of your company, whether you choose to sell it or not. This is how to build that background to make it that asset that becomes an economic engine for you.
Powerful stuff. I think with a resume as strong as yours, it's easy to focus on all the things that went really well. What's one major like challenge that you had in your career and how'd you overcome it?
Well, I've had so many, it's hard to even tell you, pick one for you. But when I actually left public accounting, I made the worst business decision of my life to go back into entrepreneurship with somebody that bought a company out of bankruptcy. And within a few short weeks, I realized there was corruption at the company. And so I was scared to death, went away for a couple of days, came back. And that's the day that there was an attorney there because the company had been involved in some litigation. I met a young man named Michael Lechter. So Napoleon Hill says, out of every adversity comes a seed of an equal or greater benefit. My worst business decision, still to this day, worst business decision gave me the best life decision. So, you know, when you make a mistake, it's an occurrence, not a definition. Just pick yourself up and keep going and just don't repeat the same mistake.
That's right. Not every business mistake will lend in eternal matrimony, but still there is opportunity, right, in our adversity. I think that's the difference of an abundance mindset, is that if we don't look at things that have happened as things that have happened to us and victim mentality, and instead say, what can I learn from this? How can I do better? And what do I need to do now to move forward? I think just the mindset shift has to happen.
Well, sometimes you need something like that to happen to wake you up. So yeah. Those things happen for you.
Yeah. When I started this radio show over 10 years ago, I did it at the time of the recession, right? And I had gone through a major setback. And a lot of it was, how can I hear of these success stories? And so a lot of my questions at that time were what I just asked you. What was a failure you had and how'd you move forward? And it was selfish. I needed advice, right? But it was cool. I got to get it from great people. But what I've learned is that the most successful people have had more failures than most people ever will have in their entire life. It's That's just true. That they face them and they handle it and they move forward and they grow.
Well, next.
Yeah.
That happened. Okay. Now, what am I going to learn from that happening? And next, let's keep going. So, yeah.
So I love Napoleon Hill and everything that they do. That's great stuff. What is some of the things that you have done with them and some lessons that entrepreneurs need to hear from that organization?
Well, I read Think and Grow Rich when I was 19, didn't realize the impact it would have on my life until I was in my 30s. And certainly if you read Rich, you know, every guru book out there has elements of Think and Grow Rich in it. Because Napoleon Hill, it was not one man's philosophy. He talked to the 500 richest men in the world at the time. So it's like the doctoral thesis of success. And so when I was asked to step in 2008, during the economic collapse back then, was to help reinvigorate his teachings. So my first book was 3 Feet from Gold. And to what you were just talking about, it's a whole series of talking to people who didn't give up, who made it through the troubles and how they did it, what encouraged them to persevere. And then the month I released that was when I got the call for this manuscript, Outwitting the Devil, that had been locked away for 73 years because Napoleon Hill had written it as a sequel to Think and Grow Rich. And as my wife was afraid of the title, so it got locked away. And when it came out, they sent it to me and it was amazing. I felt like I was in a conversation with him because it was typed on a manual typewriter with handwritten notes in the margins. And I said, this has got to get out because it talks about fear and how we can overcome that fear. That's and then amazing. When that one came out, Think and Grow Rich for Women, helping women see their own success and the fact that with the steps of success are the same, but men and women sometimes approach them very differently, and to give women those tools to recognize what will work for them as well. And so it's just been an incredible relationship. I cherish the relationship I have with the Napoleon Hill Foundation. I think everyone, I read Think and Grow Rich every single year.
I just completed it for, I think, the fourth or fifth time.
Yeah, the book doesn't change, but we do, right? So every year when I read it, it's like, I don't remember this being in here. So it's an incredible, incredible book that is as relevant today as when it was released in 1937. But for the younger generation, I do recommend you read Outwitting the Devil first, then Think and Grow Rich.
Interesting. That's cool. That isn't one I've read, so I'm excited to do that.
Oh, you'll love it.
Everyone should definitely follow you on social media, Sharon Lechter. They should go to atm.sharonlechter.com and get and sign up for Sharon's ATM, all about abundance tips and marketing. They should absolutely go and buy Exit Rich, and that's an amazing book. And we've learned a little bit about the importance of that. Man, there's a lot of things people can do to interact and learn more from you. Hope they go and do that. Sharon, my final question to you is this. Life and business is about creating, for me, it's about creating a lifestyle that we are happy and that we enjoy. What's one item on your personal bucket list you're going to accomplish in the next 12 months?
Oh, great question. I am redefining how I do my business. And I actually have three different projects in the works right now that will significantly change my life to give me more time with my grandchildren and my family, and yet still more elevate and allow me to be of contribution. I don't have to do what I'm doing, but I do it because it's my heart. I grew up in a home that said, my father would ask me each night, have you added value to someone's life today? And so to be able to have the ability to align and associate with a larger company is something that I'm looking forward to do. And I've got a couple things that are in the process. So you'll see a little different definition of how I do what I do. but I'm still very much available at SharonLechter.com and email me info@SharonLechter. And I'm going to spend more time at my ranch. Let's get that in there. CherryCreekLodge.com.
I did see that on social. People should definitely check that out. Sharon, so grateful for your being here. I think a massive amount of value, so you can answer Dad's question that you've added value today. And very, very good for you being here. To all my biz ninjas, wherever you're listening, watching, or tuning in, it's your turn to go and do something.
Thank you for listening to Biz Ninja Entrepreneur Radio with Tyler Jorgensen. Please make sure to subscribe so you're first to hear new interviews and episodes. If you found this podcast to be valuable, please share it with a friend. Don't forget to visit our online dojo at bizninja.com to claim your reward for listening to the show.